Do you have any inelastic collisions you really regret? They're usually the type of collision you regret. My most regrettable inelastic collision is when my Mitsubishi slammed into a police car in front of me. That was kind of a bummer. What happened was the police car stopped, and I didn't realize they were stopping, so I kept going. When I braked, my car leaned forward so that their bumper ran right into my engine. And we got smashed stuck together. For a moment, we both drifted forward together. This is an inelastic collision that I regret. Now maybe you can think of one you regret. In these regrettable collisions, we can actually calculate the velocities before and after the collisions. That's just what we'll do in this lesson. So let's learn about these unfortunate collisions. Let's begin by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll review inelastic collisions. That's collisions where things stick together. Then, we'll develop the equation for inelastic collisions, so we'll build it up piece by piece so you know where all the parts came from. Lastly, we'll solve inelastic collision problems using this equation. Okay, first up, what are inelastic collisions? Remember, they're collisions where things stick together. So we always want to ask, did the objects stick together? If the answer is yes, it's an inelastic collision. For inelastic collisions, recall that kinetic energy is lost. That means at least one thing slows down. Secondly, remember that shape is often permanently deformed. So you'll see cars crumpled, for example. And thirdly, and this is the most important one for this video, the final velocity of both objects is the same. And that's actually going to make our life a lot easier. So we'll take advantage of that in just a moment. Let's look at an inelastic collision problem. This says an inelastic collision occurs between a car moving at 22 miles per hour and a car moving 0 miles per hour, so at rest. Assuming both cars have a mass of 1,000 kilograms, what is the final velocity in miles per hour of both the cars once they're stuck together? They're stuck together because this is an inelastic collision. Friction should be neglected. Now, you probably have in mind that eventually these cars stop and they go 0 miles per hour, because that's eventually what happens. But remember, that's because of friction and braking. We're ignoring that. We're just saying, what's the velocity of the two cars drifting together right after they collide? All right, well, we're going to start with our equation from our elastic collision video. Here we see all of the same old variables, mass 1 times velocity 1 initial plus mass 2 times velocity 2 initial is equal to mass 1 times velocity final plus mass 2 times velocity 2 final. That's a lot. That's basically just saying the total momentum before and after the collision is the same. If that looks pretty sketchy, go ahead and check back out the elastic collision video again before moving on. Now here's the key trick in our problem. The velocity final for both cars, because they get stuck together, is the same. So those two variables are the same. So we don't need to actually label them differently. We'll just drop the ones and twos. We'll just call it velocity final. There's only one final velocity, and it's the same. Now, because it's the same, we can actually go ahead and put parentheses around this and think about pulling out velocity final. So we're going to pull that out up front. And when we simplify it, we get this equation. The velocity final times mass 1 plus mass 2. And that makes our life a lot easier. So for any inelastic collision, this is the equation you can use. And it's all because that final velocity is the same. That's what allows us to simplify this equation. So now let's actually make use of this equation. Let's solve our problem. And we're going to need to follow a couple steps. They're exactly the same ones from our elastic collisions. Step 1, identify the variables. So we just want to write down clearly what information we have in terms of all the variables from our equation. In step 2, we're going to plug in the variables that we know. And in step 3, we're going to solve for the unknown. Let's go ahead and solve this problem, shall we? We know the mass of the first car is 1,000 kilograms. Next, we know the velocity of the first car initially. And we know that's 22 miles per hour. We know the mass of the second car is also 1,000 kilograms. And we know the velocity initial of the second car is zero, it's at rest. What we're looking for is the velocity final of both cars stuck together. So they're going to collide and then both slide forward stuck together, of course, until friction slows them down all the way to zero. So we have here our equation for our inelastic collisions. And what we need to do now is just go ahead and plug in the numbers we have here for each of our variables. So for the mass, for the first one, we'll plug in 1,000, and then we'll be multiplying that by the velocity of the first car, 22, plus the mass of the second car, 1,000, times the velocity of the second car, which is zero. That's all equal to velocity final, that's our unknown, times the mass of the first car plus the mass of the second car. Well, all of this will simplify quite nicely because this whole term goes to zero. And so on the left, we'll get 22,000 equals velocity final, and then 1,000 plus 1,000 is going to give us 2,000. All right, last thing we need to do to solve here for velocity final is to divide both sides by 2,000. So we'll divide both sides by 2,000. That'll cancel out there, and we'll get 11 miles per hour equals velocity final. Now, we haven't rounded for significant figures, and in this case, we have just one sig fig for our mass, so we're gonna keep our one, and that second one will drop to a zero, and we'll get 10 miles per hour as our final answer there, rounded for sig figs. So these two cars collide. One's moving 22 miles per hour, 10 miles per hour, and then they stick together and slide forward at 10 miles per hour. Let's solve one more problem here with an inelastic collision. This problem says that a 70 kilogram ice hockey goalie catches a 0.150 kilogram hockey puck slapped at him with a velocity of 35 meters per second. Assuming the goalie is at rest before catching the puck, what is the final velocity of the puck and goalie? Assume friction can be neglected. Before we start working on this problem, let's draw a picture. First, we'll start with what it looks like before the collision actually occurs, and then we'll take a look at what it looks like after. Before, we have a hockey puck traveling forward with some velocity, and then we have a goalie who's going to catch it. So here's the goal behind him. All right, after, the situation looks a little different. Let's take a look at that. Afterwards, our goalie has now caught the puck. That's the puck in his hand. And together now, because the puck was moving, it's going to slide the goalie and the puck back towards the goal. Presumably with a slower velocity, because before we have just a puck traveling, and now that momentum is transferred to a whole person. So it's going to go slower, but it's going to continue traveling in the direction of the goal. Okay, now that we have a picture, let's go ahead and try to solve this problem. All right. Now let's go ahead and identify our variables. First up, we know the mass of the puck, which we'll call object one, and it's 0.15 kilograms, so a pretty light puck. We know the velocity of the puck initially is 35 meters per second, so it's moving pretty quick. We know the mass of object two, which is our goalie, is 70 kilograms. And then we know the velocity initial of our goalie, that's zero. What we're looking for is the velocity final of both the goalie and the puck. That's what we don't know. Now let's go ahead and plug in those variables into our equation here. We're going to plug in 0.15, which is the mass of our puck, times the velocity of our puck, which is 35. Then we're going to add the mass of our goalie, 70 kilograms, times the initial velocity of our goalie, zero. We know that's all equal to the velocity final times the velocity of our goalie plus the velocity of our puck. So we're gonna add those together. Conveniently, 70 times zero is just zero. And then we can just do 0.15 times 35. When we do that, we'll get 5.25. We know that's equal to velocity final of 70.150. That's what we get when we add those together. So if we want to solve for velocity final, we just need to divide both sides by 70.15. 70.15 will cancel out on the right, and we'll be able to solve for velocity final. 5.25 divided by 70.15 gives me 0.0748. And let's round for sig figs here. The numbers that we're given have two sig figs at the least precise. So the velocity one initial, 35, has just 1, 2 sig figs, so we'll keep 1, 2 here. That 8 there is going to make us round up. So we'll get, once we round, 0.075 meters per second for our velocity final. So that's the final velocity of our puck and our goalie, who are now drifting towards that goal. Let's review what we've learned. First, we reviewed inelastic collisions. We said those are collisions where things get stuck together, and importantly, their final velocities are the same because they're stuck together. Then we developed the equation for inelastic collisions using that common final velocity. And lastly, we solved inelastic collision problems. We actually put that equation to use. Hey, hey.